It's a pleasure for me to be here today as part of the AWE, first time with a presentation. I will give you an introduction in technology a little bit. Hopefully, it's not boring for you. But we see augmentation is a clear trend. It will be a trend also in automotive. And how this could work, I will show you. I'm coming from a development of head-up displays, and I'm not sure how familiar with head-up displays. We are able to display in front of the driver at the end information. With a normal head-up display, this information lies in 2 or 3 meter projection distance, and this information is a virtual image that flies outside of the car and gives you the information, for instance, like navigation or speed limitation information and so on. And it gives you more attention on the road because you are looking in your field of view out of the car and makes it easier for you and safer to drive a car because you are looking there where you have to look outside the car. It's a perfect information filter also because you are able to filter the information you need for your driving task, like I mentioned, navigation, for instance, or speed. And other, let's say, benefits are obviously it's an individual display for the driver, and it's also distance adaption possible because you are looking outside the car in a far distance. So this is quite agreed also for all OEMs agreeing to this topic. It's a comfort function with safety. But what we think and we believe is that we are on the way on a transition to augmentation also in this regards in with head-up displays. This means to move from non-augmented reality head-up displays to augmented reality head-up displays. This means the content is then in context with the environment behind, and this means this must somehow match to an environment behind. And what does this mean at the end? I will show you later on. But we believe then with such a system, where the content is merged together or is aligned with the environment behind, it's enabling an intuitive dialogue between the driver and the car because it shows you, for instance, if the navigation error is on the road, directly what is to do, for instance, or for other use cases like adaptive cruise control or lane departure warning. It shows you where the problem is or what the system is in which state. This means enabling such an intuitive dialogue between the driver and the car is an important issue, and this increases the trust in such systems. They are increasing in complexity in the future with, if you're thinking about the transition to new driving modes, full automatic driving cars, or even L4, for instance, where always is it possible that a takeover request comes over, that the system says, no, I cannot manage full automatically the driving situation, you have to take over. Such situations can happen, and then such a system is perfectly because it can help you to understand what should I do now. Next is it gains the gains acceptance for such systems coming up, and also I was testing such an autopilot, and as soon the dealer told me it's working only if the right lines of the lane are there visible, then you suddenly are looking only to the white lines and you're sure that the system works or not. So this is not really trustful. And this is, I think, on this transition, important to have here support by such systems. And also, if you're in a driving autonomic driving mode, it can help to monitor the maneuvers the car is planning to do. And this helps also to give you trust in such a system. This means, for instance, if there's suddenly coming up a construction area at the end and you're not sure, is this really the system knows this, it's really new since 1 week. Does it know how to come over this construction error somehow? It can show you such a system, okay, I have everything under control, I make now a round or change lane change, and I'm come over this, let's say, obstacle. And so the question is, can I really trust this system, the autopilot function or not? It's all about trust, or should I take over, so to say? So this, we think, it's a very helpful system. And I'm showing this in a video. Hopefully it starts now. This shows you, it's telling you that it's automatic driving mode. here with AD. He's showing that the errata has recognized everything on the right side. There's a warning coming up at the end. If a system like augmented reality head-up display shows this to you in your field of view, and you're feeling, okay, the system has full control of everything. The objects are recognized by the radar. The obstacle are on the right side. This, broken down Quegel was recognized and everything. And we have made here also a proband study to verify this with 24 drivers. And they faced two situations. In one situation where they had no augmented reality head-up display available, and in another situation they had one to stay available. And you can see this is a measurement. Imagine the situation. The probands were sitting in the car, in a driving demonstrator, reading the newspaper, and suddenly comes a takes-over request from the car. This was driving automatically until there, and then suddenly comes a takeover request. Oh, please take over. Put your hands on the wheel, steering wheel, and so on. If you're reading a newspaper and you're coming back to the situation of the driving mode to understand what is going on, what is the problem, why should I take over, it was much easier with augmented reality content. You can see here on the right side, is here a laser in? I don't know. This red warning signal here in the display is showing there is an broken down vehicle, and the people with augmented reality head-up display were much easier, much faster understanding, okay, there's a problem, I have to change the lane. And this is measured here in the distance from the car where they changed actively the lane to the broken down vehicle, and you can see easily, it's obvious, with augmented reality head-up display, they changed the lane much earlier, meaning more distance to the broken down vehicle here, for instance, with 150 or 200 meters in comparison to the other values without any augmented reality head-up display. So this is a clear evidence, this makes sense, and so on. And now, small step back, where we are. We are in the head-up display development here. We launched last year the first head-up display with, by the way, DMD technology, this means projector technology, with a field of view of 10 times 3 degrees based on mirrors. The principle is on the top left. We have mirrors in. Mirrors magnifying the image or the information from a DMD chip in this case, and then it's reflected to the inside of the windshield, is then reflected and it's generating a virtual image. This is a classical head-up display. This head-up display on the left side is a non augmented reality head-up display, because the content you can see here below is not really in context with the environment behind, is somewhere, but it's not somewhere overlaying really perfectly or showing the arrow here on the street. Where we want to go is to the right side. We have shown this first time 2014 with a demo car, where we have a system developed and demonstrated also as a system. This means also generated content, augmented content for three use cases: navigation, lane departure warning, and adaptive cruise control. The system here is on the right top, somehow schematically shown. We have realized an IR layer in a far distance, like normal head-up displays, around 7 meters. And the second layer, this green layer, this was a blue layer, the green layer was normal distance 2 meters as a static information layer where we can display at the end informations like before with non-augmented reality head-up displays. And here you can see on the right side, this is a navigation fishbone elements where we are showing here, and this was really, you could experience this live in the car. And they're showing shortly in video, and only to give you an idea about this. There comes an intro element, this is non-augmented, and then it's moving on the street, and then you see these fishbone elements at the end and how they are starting to rotate, indicating the driver. Here you have to change the lane to leave the highway, and then if he is changing the lane, then you see how they are switching to a straight direction. On the below, you can see this information about the speed and navigation content and the status of the ADAS function. So this is, we have shown 2014. Now we are working on to introduce in the market. But if you're looking at demands of our customers, they want to have augmentation. They want to have augmented reality head-up displays. What does it mean? If you're coming from systems like we have in the market, quite a lot, they have they are small, 3 to 4 liters somehow. They are with small image sizes around 6 times 2 degrees field of view, and so on. And when you want to realize such augmented reality head-up display, like I've shown in the video, as you can see here on the right side, we have realized here with this optics, classically with mirrors, with DMD technology and TFT to have 2 layers, we need 15 to 17 liters volume. Yeah, this means a lot. And if you imagine this is built in the dashboard of a car, this is, so to say, a lot of space. And if you want to fulfill the demands of the market, to even, because the system has an image size of 10 times 5 degrees, to give you an idea, and 7-meter projection is, and the demand of the market is to even to increase the image size to even 15 or 20 degrees. This means, based on the optics, it's really physics, it's always the same, of all the same, you have to realize 30 liters or somehow 40 liters in the dashboard. But the problem, the conflict is, and the reason for this is, if you're increasing the image size, the width of your packaging is increased, and if you're increasing the projection distance, this means the depth of the system is increased, the distance of the internal optical components is increased. So this means larger image sizes, larger projection distance, we are moving to 30 and 40 liters. Is this realistic? I think no, not because designers of car makers, like for instance, only these both here, if you're looking at a Tesla 3 or this e-next car from BMW, the designers, they are moving to flat designs, flat dashboard designs, and so on. And you can imagine there's no space for 40 liters, suddenly, in their design. So this is a conflict, and the question was, for us, for me, from Optic Technologies, Adrian, to solve this somehow, is there a solution for? Otherwise, we will fail. We cannot fulfill the demand of the customers of the market with solutions if we are following mirror-based solutions. So we are in a moment where we have to make this comparison. We have a bulky television set from the 60s, 70 years, and we want to move somehow to flat screens. This is a step we want to fulfill. And on the left side, you see this system, 17 liters. This is a bulky television set, a brown electron ray, let's say, television set, and we want to move to a flat screen. And the solution behind here to realize such a flat, mirrorless solution is to use, at the end, plates, glass plates with a holographic inside, and to build the picture totally different. This means by letting the light propagating in this glass and putting it at the end together again, because you can see 3 layers, 3 glass plates, one for green, one for red, and one for blue. And then we are putting this at the end together to full color, then we can also achieve here a full color image, but totally different. And I will show you why we are starting with this. What did we identify? First of all, you can see here the packaging size. If you're comparing system by system with the parameters field of view and projection distance, you can save a lot of space if we are able to do this. Why did we start with such a development? We recognized a startup in Silicon Valley named DigiLens, and we have started here also a cooperation with them. This is published, everything. And we are working with them strongly together. And why did we identify them? And so on. We saw them the first with a demonstrator on the CES 2016 with such an application, a motor helmet application with a waveguide HUD, means a transmittive waveguide combiner solution. You can see this here on the motor helmet on the left bottom side. This is a unit at the end where can you looking through, and this image is generated like in a glass. If you're going here on the exhibition, you can see similar application. Then you can easily see on the top left side augmented content for the motor driver at the end, speed, gear, whatever construction areas coming up at the end. How does this work with this here? DigiLens has here developed in a technology with a pico projector. They're coupling the information in such a waveguide. The information is then propagating inside the waveguide along. You can see this on the bottom side, and then it's diffracted upwards, and then finally it's coupled out with a third grating structure to the human eye. And so we thought, and I thought, okay, this could be a solution, but we are applying this different, because looking through in a car, this means in the windshield something to do, it's dangerous to make this in the windshield, because it's curved, the windshield also. So we thought about to make this not transmittive, but reflective. This means we are putting this technology in the dashboard flat, with the same approach, and then we are coupling with the light from downwards in this plates in, and then we're letting the light propagating around in the waveguide, and then finally it's coupled out, it's reflected at the windshield, and it's then building classically the virtual image and the iBox of the driver so that he can see this image in a certain area. This we are calling iBox. So this is how it works, and the challenge is here to scale up. This means from a small solution in front of the human eye of the motor helmet to scale this up to sizes we need and also make this happen here for automotive conditions. This is our task where we are in with our competence and yet to realize this. How does it work? Maybe shortly for you, hopefully I'm not so boring for you, means we are using here this technology. We have three glass plates, one for green, one for blue, one for red. We are putting there some gratings in, like in the application of the motor helmet. And then you see here some lines that are representing the gratings. We have an input grating where the light is coupled in from a projector. It's then sidewards propagating to the fold grating, and then here diffracted to the long side of the waveguide is then finally coupled out and generates the image. On the right side, you can see this, and we are generating the iBox by this propagation of the light along the short and along the long side, and have a short animation. Hopefully, it works. To show this, we are putting three plates together for each color one. We have the gratings here in. We have a PGU where the light, the information, the picture comes from. The light is here coupled in by this gratings. It's propagating along one side, then to another side. We are getting here the spots on the top, and we are overlaying three colors to each other, and then we are reflecting this at the windshield, and we are setting together a full color image, like we know from normal head-up displays. This is how it works. And we have shown already this beginning this year on the CES show in Las Vegas. We have realized this. This is the first mirrorless full-color holographic waveguide. And you can see here the glass plates on the left side open, and this black box is covering at the end this picture generating unit. It's out of the shelf. It's not optimized for a project. So this is not representing, let's say, the end of the design. On the right side, you can see this virtual image. And this virtual image lies in infinity. This is also something new. It's not 2 meters, it's not 7 meters, it's not 10 meters, it's infinity. This is one big step. And the image size is not 10 times 5, it's 15 times 5. And even possible, it's able to cover more and field size. So this is a very new thing. So we are very excited, we are working very hard on this. But what you can see here is that this is realized with a flat screen, flat windshield. The small piece of glass on the top is representing the windshield. This is flat, this is not realistic. We are in the world of curved windshields. And now our next step, now our next challenge is to realize this really with a curved windshield, and we will have this next year. And we are working here, and I'm working here on this topic. So I'm almost on the last slide. What is the benefit of this technology? First of all, we are able to offer our customers large field of use, larger field of use in comparison also to other systems. We are enabling to fit to new dashboard designs, dashboard designs, because we have a stack of glass only, no mirrors anymore. We are achieving a new range of projection distance, infinity. And we are now realizing a windshield correction. This means so that we are getting more power, optical power in this waveguide, to realize also a pre-correction, pre-compensation of the windshield correction. And this is the next step with new gradings. And the other topic is, this is a special topic for Hood guys and Hood developers, is thermal aspects. Because you can imagine, sunlight is also hitting your car. And if you have an optical system in the dashboard, you're not only projecting in one direction, you're also collecting light, focusing light from the sunlight. And this is also critical. And even if the image size are getting larger and larger, the mirrors is normally larger, they're collecting more light, is thermal instability and so on. But these are details. With this system, you have such problems not, because we are managing here only parallel light. The other topic is also a specialty in head-up displays, that you normally need a wedge ankle foil in the windshield, and we believe with this system you don't need this anymore. So what is it all about? We believe that with this disruptive, really game-changing approach of holographic waveguide, we are enabling to meet really demands of our customers, and this is for us a challenge and for us exciting topic, but we believe this is a must to be prepared for the future. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Pablo. When are we going to see that? When am I going to see that in my Mercedes?
We are calling start of production. We are thinking this is 2023 available, because we are in a pre-development phase.
2023?
Yes.
I call you on that.
I want to have it.
Any other question? Oh, plenty.
Thank you. Why did you choose DigiLens technology? I mean, there are many diffractive waveguide technologies out there. Can you elaborate on that?
Yes, because we believe this with this material, this special material, in the end, this has a certain characteristic and properties to really not be limited regarding the field of view. Because it's all about diffraction efficiency and so on, about a really large size. And we believe with this behind, I cannot tell you in each detail, we believe that this is an extraordinary solution for that. Yes?
Front in the front.
Are there any issues with blurring or chromatic aberration with waveguide, and how are you addressing that?
Absolutely. So this means we are developing a laser PGU for that to come over this. This is absolutely an important question. But we believe to solve this, and this is exactly the point about such a large size at the end to get this, and also with the new gradings we are developing to pre-compensate windshields, but with a certain development in the PGU part, we are believing we are coming over this topic. But this is a typical optical question.
There was a question in the back first, please. Okay.
Hi, I have a question. So if you actually want to track something, so you're integrating it with your ADAS systems, you want to track a car that's out there, people have different heights and often will sit differently. So in order to move the iBox to register it to the driver, do you have to tilt the entire diffractive grading waveguide, or is there another way to do it?
There's another way to do it. But can you imagine that we don't want to move the complete waveguide? But sorry about that, I cannot tell you more.
Sort of along the same question is, like, if you're thinking about using like AR where you're tracking things and things are moving in and out, as far as things far away coming closer, does the technology that you're proposing, does it change the depth of the image so it feels like it's moving, or is it always an infinity?
It's an infinity. Yeah.
We have a question here.
I'm not sure I understood how the system avoids reflection from the sun. So when some sun comes down to the waveguide and then reflects through the windshield to the eyes.
Very good question. This is a challenge. We have there different, I would say, approaches to do that. Also, this cannot tell you today. Yeah. But this is a very important question. We have always in head-up display business, and you can imagine, we cannot put only a glass plate on the dashboard, like we did for the CS demonstrator. This gives horrible reflections, but this was a demonstrator. And how we resolve this for a serious product, it's a secret. Sorry about that.
Thank you.
Got another question here. Oh, we can take this first then, yeah?
Yeah, very quick one. If you're on the passenger seat, what will you see?
Nothing.
Thank you.
Do you think you have a problem with the daylight intensity problem? Do you have enough intensity in the waveguide to also that it's also visible during day?
Yes, it will have. Because we are, this is why we are in the story, with our experience, we are a reference to our normal head-up displays, and this is a classic specification topic. We have to fulfill the same brightness, same contrast, and so on. Exactly. And we believe this is possible.
We can take a couple of more questions. Maybe whilst you think, I've got a question, building the bridge to AR again. I mean, display is one thing. How is your research related to all the sensor technologies and the experience to actually make something visible and in augmented reality to provide some useful information?
Yes, so we are able to do this. We have shown this already 2014. We are working on this. We have the capability to develop the data fusion topic. We are calling this AR Creator, where the content is then generated and then is prepared for projection, so to say, because we are projecting in front of you. And this is an additional challenge to make this in time with all latencies of sensors, whatever you have. So we have here competency in the house and also corporations to do this, and HMI people to supporting. But in the end, our experience is, HMI at least, the OEMs taking over because they want to fit this in their total holistic designs, colors, and so on. But here we are supporting them and consulting.
Okay. There's one more question in the back.
Yeah, just one question. Do you have any issues with polarized sunglasses?
Yes, we have one. if you're comparing what I've shown before is what we launched last year. This was a DMD-based solution, maybe as a non-augmented lenses. There we have the topic that also with a polarized sunglasses you can see your image. At least it's not the same bright than without. But it's possible. But in this solution, not, unfortunately. Because we use also polarization. Unfortunately, the wrong. But it's this reason, physics behind. We can discuss this later, if you want.
Cool. If there's no more questions, thank you very much, Pablo.
Yeah, it was a pleasure.
It was great meeting you.
Yes, okay. Thank you.